Praise the Lord. Is the church there? I said, praise the Lord. Victorious youth, good morning. How are we today? How are we going to be this year? Victory upon victory in Jesus' name. Church, how are you this new year? Oh, by the way, this is my first time of seeing your face this year. Happy New Year! Something more coming your way in Jesus' name. This is that year you have been expecting. It'll give you something more which is worth living for. This year, praise the Lord. You'll have so much, you'll be so excited. Everybody will be looking at you. What makes you happy? You see, because every day, every week, every month, throughout the year, something more. Something more. And your life will be worth living in Jesus' name. All the tiredness and weakness and weariness and drooping and sleeping, what am I going to do today? All that is gone. Amen. You'll have something more. Amen. And of course, in this service, today, something more. Amen. The Lord bless everyone in Jesus' name. Let's have a word of prayer. Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank you because you are there for your people. Always blessing your people. Always enriching your people. Always maintaining the faithfulness that you manifest in fulfilling your promise for the children of God. Lord, I pray this very day you bring something more to every life in Jesus' name. Something more in our hearts. Something more in our lives. Something more in every believer in Jesus' name. I pray that nobody here today will go back empty-handed in Jesus' name. Enlighten us. Revive us. Shake everything shakeable out of every life in Jesus' name. Mountains of problems will flee away. All the discouragement in your heart will flee away. You will leave this place tonight, know today, knowing that God has given you something more. You'll make progress this year. From strength to strength this year. The abiding power of the Lord will always give you something more in Jesus' name. You'll always have more than you expect. Confirm it, Lord, in every life. In Jesus' name we pray. Thank you very much. We're coming to Galatians chapter 4, chapter 1. Galatians chapter 1. I'm reading from verse 4. Who gave himself for our sins, that he might deliver us. Make it personal. That he might deliver me from the present evil world, according to the will of God and our Father. It's the will of God to deliver you, set you free, keep you free from everything that is evil in the world, and you're free in Jesus' name. Chapter 2, verse 20. I am crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live. You are going to live. Amen. An exciting life. Amen. A victorious life. Amen. A happy life. A life that is untouchable by any evil hand. And a life that is strong. A life that is firm. That's why he says, I am crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live. Yet not I, but Christ liveth in me. And the life which I now live in the flesh, I live by the faith of the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. This year, you will live by faith. Amen. Chapter 3, I'm reading from verse 13. Christ has redeemed us from the curse of the law, being made a curse for us. For it is written, cursed is everyone that hangeth on a tree. We need to realize that when Christ died on the cross of Calvary, he bore the curse for you. He lifted that curse out of your head. Lifted the curse away from your family. And he says, I'm taking the curse of the law, and the curse of tradition, and the curse of men, and the curse coming from any direction. He has taken it away from you. You are free. And this year you'll experience that in your life. Every area of your life will experience that redemption and that freedom in Jesus' name. And it says that the blessing of Abraham might come upon the Gentiles through Jesus Christ, that we might receive. Why don't you make that personal? That I might receive the promise of the Spirit through faith. I've got it. I said I have got it. We're looking at chapter 4. And I'm reading from verse 6. Chapter 4, verse 6. It says, and because ye are sons, God has sent forth the Spirit of his Son into your hearts, crying, Abba, Father. You see, these Galatian believers were so ignorant. They thought they didn't have enough. And some people were bringing some things to them. And they were saying, you know what? You will still need to go through circumcision. That somebody, a human being, they said, what God has done in converting them, what God had done in circumcising their heart, what God had done in pulling them out of the dungeon and lifting them up to the mountaintop of victory through Jesus Christ, they said that wasn't enough. They said somebody, a human being, must add his own circumcision, and he must take the knife and cut off something from their flesh. The spirit saved, the soul saved, and their body healed, because by his stripes were healed. And they said, what God has done is not enough. And they said, what Calvary stands for is not enough. We must still do something. We've got everything in Christ. I said, you have got everything in Christ. There are people that will still try to bring to you, did you have oil? Did you have candle? Did you have white garments? Did you have this one? Did you have that one? I have everything in Christ. I said I have everything in Christ. The blood of Jesus is greater than your oil, and the white garment of righteousness, because he has clothed us with the garment of salvation and with the robe of righteousness. That is greater than any piece of clothes anybody can send to you. Christ who died on the cross of Calvary is greater than any picture of any church founder you are hanging on your wall. Saying, if I look at that picture, if I touch that picture, there is something more than picture here. I said there's something more than picture. The blood of Jesus, the cross of Calvary, that cancels every evil out of your life. He has set you free, and thank God you are free. He has given you the blessing of Abraham. And because you are children of God, he has sent his spirit upon your heart, and you are crying, Abba, Father. He tells us in verse 7, wherefore thou art no more a servant. Give me a good amen. You're no more a slave, is a servant. I don't know what master will say today. I'm fearful. I am timid. I'm looking at his face. I'm watching whether he will smile or whether he will frown. You have gone beyond that. This year is a year of strength. This year is the year of power. This year is the year of victory. You are the son of the king. You are a child of the king. And everybody, there is authority upon your life. I said there's authority upon your life. You are not a slave. You are not a captive. You are not a coward. He has not given us the spirit of fear. He has given us the spirit of the living God. And he shouts from our hearts, Abba, Father. That word Abba in the original Greek means daddy. Daddy, Father. And you can call him your dad, your daddy, and you love him. He loves you. And you know that he's going to supply every need of your life in Jesus' name. Wherefore thou art no more a servant, but a son. And if a son, then an heir. You are inheriting something. And the heir of God through Christ. You see, as you go through the epistle to the Galatians, he's telling us, don't stay in the dungeon there. And don't think you still need something, that Christ is not sufficient, that Calvary is not enough, that the cross still is missing something. It tells us, I've read chapter 1, I've read chapter 2, I've read chapter 3, I've read chapter 4, come to chapter 5. It says in chapter 5, verse 1, stand fast therefore in the liberty where Christ has made us free. Read that all over again. Stand therefore. Stand fast, therefore, in the liberty wherewith Christ has made you free. Any free person there? Any delivered person there? This year is going to be glorious. As you stand firm, as you stand fast, and you will not allow anything to shake you, greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. Look at Calvary. Look at what the cross has done. Look at what Christ has provided for you. Now that you are free, don't you ever go back to bondage again. You are free, and free permanently in Jesus' name. Stand fast therefore in the liberty, in the freedom, in the deliverance wherewith Christ has made us free, and be not entangled again with the yoke of bondage. There's no entanglement anymore. It tells us in chapter 6 verse 14, but God forbid that I should glory save in the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ, by whom the world is crucified unto me. You know where we're coming from? In chapter 1, verse 4. It says, the present evil world, he has delivered us out of the present evil world. It comes to the end of the epistle. And it says, that evil world is crucified unto me. Is made impotent, powerless, is destroyed. The power of the occultic world is destroyed in your life. The power of the traditional world is destroyed in your life. The power of the satanic world is destroyed in your life. And the power of any evil in the world, you're free. I'm looking at a free man right there. I'm looking at a free woman right there. I'm looking at people that know their rights in Christ. And they know whatever the charm in the world, they're crucified. I said they're crucified. And whatever the evil, they may have conspiracy anywhere, gather anywhere and throw something at you. It says, I glory in the cross of Christ, by whom the world is crucified unto me, and I unto the world. Then it says, for in Christ Jesus neither circumcision availeth anything, nor uncircumcision, but a new creature. Who is the new creature? I said, who is the new creature? You're new, and all the old fears, and all the old cobweb, and all the old challenges, they are buried with the past life. Christ has made you free. You're free indeed in Jesus' name. As you look at all those verses I've read to you, you will see already that we are overcomers in Christ. We are conquerors in Christ. And we have the victory in Christ. I'm now talking to you today on maintaining the overcomer's victory in Christ. Maintaining the overcomer's victory in Christ. You'll maintain that victory in your life throughout this year and for the rest of your life in Jesus' name. Now, what we see here, number one, I see conversion. As you look at the life of Paul the Apostle, he wasn't always like this. He didn't always believe in the cross. He didn't always have the victory on the cross. But now he was converted. And it is because of that conversion, he now says there is crucifixion. And many people, in fact, Paul the Apostle, before this time, anytime he had crucifixion, he'd be looking at the past. He'd be looking at what happened on Calvary. Only to Jesus Christ, all of a sudden he realized that crucifixion is not just him alone. I am crucified with Christ. I am crucified with Christ. If there is any reason, any basis, any foundation of living the victorious life, it is that crucifixion with Christ. And then eventually it says, I am now a conqueror. I said, you are now a conqueror. Are you there? You are now a conqueror. There are three things we're looking at. Number one, the proof of a converted soul. The proof of a converted soul. As we come to Paul the Apostle, and we see Paul the Apostle, he gives us the evidence. He says, if you want to know whether you are converted or not, if you want to know whether what Christ did on the cross of Calvary has availed for you, look at the proof in my life. You will see the proof in your life as well. Where are you? I said you'll see the proof in your life. Number one, the proof of a converted soul. Number two, the portrait of a crucified self. The portrait of a crucified self. You know, when you identify with Christ on the cross of Calvary, and you say, I am with him. He is with me. I was crucified with him. I died with him. I was buried with him. I am risen with him. Victory will never lack in your life. It is the man who is totally, completely identified with Christ from crucifixion to glorification that step by step, I will never leave you, and he will never leave you, and your hands are in the hands of Christ. Your mind is the mind of Christ. Your vision is the vision of Christ. Your goal, your purpose, your desire is the goal and the purpose and the desire of Christ. And you are so intimately joined with Christ that you say, I'm crucified with him. I am buried with him. And because of that, I was also risen with him. And now I live with him. And I live by the faith of the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. Every day of your life, every moment of the day, you will be victorious. This year, you will wake up. You will not compare yourself to all the people in your community. You will know you are different. I said you will know you are different because Christ is with you and you are with Christ, identified with him every time. Point number three now, the power of a conquering spirit. The power of a conquering spirit. Before you go this day, that power will walk inside your heart. Anything that is not of God in your life, in your family, everything will be totally taken away in Jesus' name. You will not be hopeless again. You will not be helpless again. You will not say, I don't know what I'm going to do. Your resources will be greater than your need. the solution will be as broad, as wide, as great as the problem in your life in Jesus' name. You will have an energized spirit, an enlightened spirit, a mighty spirit, a courageous spirit, and the spirit of the conqueror will be upon your life in Jesus' name. The power of a conquering spirit. Number one. What's number one again now? The proof of a converted soul. We're coming to Galatians chapter 1. In Galatians chapter 1, I'm reading from verse 1. It tells us in chapter 1, verse 1, Paul, an apostle, not of men, neither by man, but by Jesus Christ and God the Father, who raised him from the dead. You see, he said, I have relationship with the God of heaven. I have relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ, who loved me, gave himself for me, died for me, and then he rose again. And then when he mentioned Jesus Christ, he said, see what Jesus has done. Not just what Jesus has done for the old world, what Jesus has done for me. And when you can say that, he did something for me. I said he did something for me. And you can point to what he has done. Look at verse 4. Who gave himself for our sins. He's saying, you look at Saul of Tarsus. And you said, he's a great sinner. Look at what he did. And you begin to count. 1, 2, 3. And then you stop. He said, have you stopped counting? Keep on counting. And then you're looking at him. You say, great sinner. Big sinner. Wicked sinner. Terrible sinner. He said, you have not completed what you are saying. Christ gave himself for my sin. He took all those sins away. He has forgiven me. He has changed my life. I am born again. And when you can say that yes, I was a sinner. Who says I wasn't a sinner? But you see, that's of the past. Because Jesus Christ gave himself for me. I repented of my sin. I looked at Calvary. I looked at Jesus Christ. And the moment I looked at Jesus Christ, number one, the punishment of my sin, he has taken away. The pollution of my sin, number two, he has taken away. The power, number three, of my sin, he has taken away. Number four, the presence of my sin, he has taken away. He has taken my sins away, and he put them in the depths of the sea. I cannot see them anymore. As the east is far from the west, so as he removed my sin away from me, because he gave himself for our sins, that he might deliver us from this present evil world, according to the will of God and our Father. Is the will of God that everyone will have that conversion. I said it's the will of God that everyone will have that conversion. And if you have not got it yet, this morning is coming your way in Jesus' name. And now look at what it says in verse 15. The proof of a converted soul. In verse 15, it says, but when it pleased God, who separated me from my mother's womb, and he called me by his grace, I had his call. He said, Saul, Saul, I had my name. I looked up, I said, who are you, Lord? He said, I am Jesus, whom you are persecuting. Immediately I surrendered. When you surrender your life to the Lord Jesus Christ, you know, he had a goal, he had a mission, he had something he was going for. He was going to Damascus. He had a letter in his hand, a letter to go and arrest all the Christians. All of a sudden he said, my journey to Damascus is going to change. My intention of going to Damascus is going to change. And all I've been doing since I became knowledgeable, accountable, everything is going to change. He said, now I stop the past to the present. What will you have me to do? That's conversion. When you come to the point in your life, and you say, all the journey I've been making, all the things I've been doing, I see that they are wrong. I now need a new life. I need a new plan. I need a new direction. And I'm asking, I say, Lord, he accepted him as Lord. He believed him as Lord. He surrendered his life to Christ as Lord. And he said, you are now the master of my life, the controller of my life, the director of my life. You are now the planner of my life. Lord, what will you have me to do? The proof of a converted soul. When you come to that point in your life, that you say, it's no more my will. It's no more what I desire. It's no more where I want to go. I'm asking the Lord, what did he want me to do? He says, when he pleased the Lord, God, who separated me from my mother's womb, and he called me by his grace to reveal his son in me, that I might preach him among the heathen. Immediately, he said, I didn't delay, immediately I conferred not with flesh and blood. When you hear the call of God, call to repentance. When you hear the call of God, the call to salvation. When you hear the call of God, call to righteousness. When you hear the call of God, call to sanctification. When you hear the call of God, call to a new life, a new direction, a new journey, a new assignment given by the Lord and by the Lord alone. And you say, yes, Lord, I accept. Yes, Lord, I receive. Yes, Lord, I will. That is the proof. Because you have now surrendered your life, your mind, your will, your goal, your intention, everything you have, you have surrendered unto the Lord. Be my Lord. Be my controller. Be my director. And you said that sincerely. And you're waiting for him to give you the directives as where next to go, what next to do, and what to be a new creature in Christ. I pray it will happen in your life. If it has happened already, we will see the evidence in your life in Jesus' name. I conferred not with flesh and blood. Verse 22. In verse 22, and I was unknown by face unto the children, unto the churches of Judea, which were in Christ, but they had heard only that he which persecuted us in times past now preaches the gospel, the faith, the word, which once he destroyed. Can you see that? That's the proof of conversion. That all he was doing before, persecuting. All he was doing before, wickedness, evil. But now, he does not do that anymore. He's not preaching the gospel. He's not promoting the gospel. He's now exalting the Christ of the gospel. That is the change that comes in the life of a man who is truly converted. There'll be a proof in your life if you are converted. There'll be a change in your life if you are converted. There'll be a transformation in your life if you are converted. You'll be able to say, the things I used to do, I do them no more. The things I used to drink, I drink them no more. And the things I used to wear, I wear them no more. And the paintings I used to have, I don't have that or anymore. And all the friendship of the world I used to have, everything is gone. Things are different now because Christ has come into my life. He has come to me. And I pray that from this very day, that change will be seen in your life in Jesus' name. In 1 Thessalonians chapter 1. 1 Thessalonians chapter 1. I'm reading from verse 5. 1 Thessalonians chapter 1 verse 5. For our gospel came not unto you in word only. It came not in word only. There are people, they hear the gospel, it only goes to the head. And it doesn't do anything in their heart or in their lives. But Paul the apostle said, concerning these Thessalonians, he says, it has not come to you in word only, but in power and in the Holy Ghost. Then it says, and in much assurance, as you know what manner of men we were among you for your sakes. And ye became, that's conversion. Ye became, a change happened. That you were like this before, now you heard the gospel, a transformation has happened, and ye became followers of us and of the Lord, having received the word in much affliction with joy of the Holy Ghost, so that ye were examples to all that believe in Macedonia and Achaia. Their lives became so different. Their life became so transformed that even other people were looking at them. They were saying, if God can change that smoker, he can change me. If God can change that idol worshiper, he can change me. If God can change that violent man, that man used to fight, he will get angry at the snap of the finger. Any little thing will irritate him. If God can change that man, that woman, God can change me. They became examples. You'll be an example. I said you'll be an example. But if you say you are a Christian and we're preaching to other people, I will say God will change you. God will transform your life. They say, what do you mean? So and so also says he's born again. He says he's also a child of God. I cannot see any difference in his life. He's still the same as he used to be. He still lies the way he used to lie. And he still drinks and gets drunk the way he used to drink. Because we are the people selling that go to him, and we sell it to him, and he still comes. He goes to your church. They cannot see a change. They will see a change this year. I said they will see a change this year. They will say, now we see that man is different. Now we see that woman is different. You will be different in Jesus' name. For from you sounded out the word of the Lord, not only in Macedonia and Achaia, but also in every place your faith to God's word is spread abroad, so that we need not speak anything. For they themselves show of us what manner of entering in we urge unto you, how ye turned. That's it. How ye turned, that's a transformation. That's a change. You cannot say, I'm born again, and you have not turned from your past life. You cannot say, I'm a child of God, you have not turned from your past life. The proof of a converted soul, the proof that now we quit the past and we come to a new life in the present, is that we have turned from everything of the past. We have turned to God, from idols, to serve the living and true God, and to wait for his Son from heaven, whom he raised from the dead, even Jesus, which delivered us from the wrath to come. It means that even the coming judgment at the end of the world, it is cancelled in Jesus' name, because he has delivered us from the wrath to come. And let's come back to Galatians chapter 5. Galatians chapter 5, the proof of a converted soul, the change that happens. It tells us in chapter 5 verse 19, it says, now the works of the flesh are manifest, which are these: adultery, fornication. Then it says uncleanness, lasciviousness. Those are the characteristics of the past life. Idolatry, witchcraft. And then hatred, bitterness, hatred, malice, variance, and emulations, wrath, strife, seditions, heresies, envies, jealousy, murder with abortion, drunkenness, revelings, and such like, of the which I tell you before, as I also told you in time past, that they which do such things shall not do what? Tell me out loud. Shall not inherit the kingdom of God. But if we're going to inherit the kingdom of God, there must be a change, a transformation. The proof of a converted soul was that, but there's a change now, but there's a transformation now, but this is not the proof that you are converted, a converted soul. But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, faith, meekness, temperance, that's self-control. Against such there is no law. And they that are Christ's, they that belong to Christ, they that have the proof of through conversion, a converted soul, they have crucified the flesh with the affections and the lust. That evidence of salvation will be in your life this year in Jesus' name. Point number two, the portrait of crucified self. The portrait of a crucified self. We're looking at Galatians chapter 2. Galatians chapter 2. You know what the Apostle Paul is doing here is saying, now you Galatian believers, what's happening to you? You have graduated normally from primary school. You have graduated from even secondary. And you have graduated from the undergraduate spiritual school or college. And now somebody is coming to you, is bringing you back into kindergarten. Is bringing you into the preliminary before class one. What I mean is this, long ago in Genesis, at the primary, at the kindergarten of the revelation of the mind of God. Because you know, as you look at the Bible, God began to reveal himself. He spoke in dreams. He spoke in vision. He spoke with concrete things. He spoke with tangible things you can touch, you can see, you can feel. That's what we do in the kindergarten. When you want to teach a little boy, a little girl that just comes to think kindergarten, that you want to say half plus half is equal to one. The child does not understand that. That's kindergarten. Therefore, you take a knife, you cut paper or cut orange or cut anything into two. You say this is one out of two, one over two. This other one is one out of two, one over two. We call one over two half. Then you ask the child, what do we call one over two half? Now, this is half, this is half. Then I join those two together, half plus half class. Tell me, is equal to one. But that little child will not know that until you take something and cut. And then you join. You say, anytime you're going, you see half plus half. That one, you join them together. You say, that is one. Kindergarten. And so God was teaching them long ago that you will be circumcised. So that will make a difference between you and all the Gentile nations. And so everybody from Genesis, circumcision. And now Christ came and said, now because Christ has come, you graduate from all that kindergarten knowledge, all that primary school knowledge. Now the blood of Jesus Christ, his son, cleanses you from all sin. Praise the Lord. I am saved. You don't have to see something. You don't have to touch something. You don't have to cut something. You don't have to join something. You don't have to go back to kindergarten. Now you just look, believe, and thou shalt be saved. And now you are saved. And after they were saved, there were people coming to them now saying, you are saved without touching anything. We are saved without cutting anything. You are saying without joining two things together, how did you get your result? How did you know half plus half is one without cutting an orange? Now come back. Everybody come back. Leave that paper. Leave that desk there and sit down here. Cut this thing. And then I see you again. You are cutting orange. I say, my friend, what are you doing here? Am I not the one that taught you abstract? Abstract means don't touch anything. Don't see anything. Just say half plus half class. Tell me, how did you know? See, you didn't cut orange. How did you know? See, you didn't cut paper. Because now you have let all those rudiments, all the preliminary, all the primary, you have let that. That's how you know. The same thing he was telling them. You don't need to cut your body. You don't need to circumcise your body. Now Jesus Christ has died for you. Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and thou shalt be saved. You don't need to go to Jerusalem and be looking for the place where they crucified Jesus anywhere in the world now, without traveling anywhere, whosoever shall call on the name of the Lord shall be saved. That's the problem the Galatians had. That's why he said, oh foolish Galatians, who is troubling you again and bewitching you and taking you back to that place? Now we're free. I said, now we're free. That's why he now came to tell them about the crucified life. We're looking at the portrait of the crucified self, Galatians chapter 2. And I'm reading from verse 20, Galatians chapter 2, verse 20. I am crucified with Christ. Give me a great amen there. It says, nevertheless I live. Now, again, that's going beyond sense knowledge. When you crucify somebody, how does that person dies? But he says, I am crucified with Christ. He's talking spiritually. He didn't have to go to Calvary. He didn't have to go to Golgotha. He said, where I am now, in the place where I am now, by faith in Christ, I identify with him. I am crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live, yet not I, but Christ liveth in me, and the life which I now live is a new life. I say it's a new life, eternal life, spiritual life, a victorious life. The life which I now live in the flesh, I live by the faith of the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me. You live by this faith. I said, you live by this faith. He said, the faith of the Son of God. What's the faith of the Son of God? The faith that knows everything reaching concerning me will be fulfilled. That's the faith of Christ. He said, as he was talking to disciples, he said, everything reaching concerning me has an end. And you come in this new year, you see, I'm crucified with Christ. My old thoughts are crucified. My weakness crucified, even my self-life crucified, and the weakness of my life, all that is hanging on the cross. I turn my back on that weakness. I turn my back on my old life. Now I live by the faith of the Son of God, who loved me so much, and he gave himself for me. He says, it's not me living anymore. Who is living in me? Who is living in you? Christ liveth in me. And when he talks about this self that was crucified, let me show you an illustration. It's in Isaiah chapter 14. Isaiah chapter 14. And I'm reading here from verse 12. Isaiah chapter 14, we're looking at verse 12. You will see what it says. It's no longer I living, it's Christ living the life in me, the self-life. I, all that has been crucified. We're looking at Isaiah chapter 14. Let me back up to verse 12. How art thou fallen from heaven, O Lucifer, son of the morning? How art thou cut down to the ground, which didst weaken the nations? For thou hast said in thine heart, this self. And this is what you find in every man, every woman, everyone on earth. Concentration on self. Concentration on I. And Paul the apostle said, now that I, that self-life is crucified. This morning, the self-life in each of us will be crucified in Jesus' name. Look at the self-life now. Look at the I, the self, that ought to be crucified. I will ascend into heaven. I will. I will exalt my throne above the throne, the stars of God. See the self-life. I will sit also upon the mount of the congregation in the sides of the north. That's a self-life. In verse 14, I will ascend above the heights of the clouds. I will be like the Most High. That is, I'm going to have that position. If he doesn't give me, I take it, I seize it. That's the self-life. That's why Paul, you know Paul the apostle, before he became converted, before he came to Christ, I will arrest them. I will punish them. I will take them. I will fight against this gospel. I will scatter them. I will destroy the church. Everything was I, the self-life. But now Paul said, now I am crucified with Christ. It's the nature of Satan in man. And that's why, as you come in this new year, Satan will not have any place in you. Anything that will raise up its ugly head and will say, I will, and then you push God out. You take God out. That's what they call ego. Ego means E-G-O. Edging God out. Ego. That is the self-life that says, I am, and there's none else. Look at Isaiah. Isaiah chapter 45. Isaiah chapter 45. And I'm reading here from verse 6. And see, this is the language of God. I am and none else. Only God should say that. Isaiah chapter 45 verse 6. That they may know from the rising of the sun and from the west that there is none beside me. I am the Lord and there is none else. God has the right to say that. God has the capacity of saying that. God has the power to say that. And God has everything it takes. He's the creator of the heavens and the earth. There is none like him. And he could say, I am the Lord. There is none else. Look at verse 21. In verse 21 of that same chapter, here is what God is saying. Tell ye, and bring them near. Yea, let them take counsel together. Who has declared this from ancient time? Who has told it from that time? Have not I the Lord, and there is no God else beside me, a just God and a Savior. There is none beside me. That's God. Only God can say that. Only God shall say that, because he is and none else. He is mighty and none else. He is powerful and none else. He is great and none else. There is no competition. But when somebody has the self-life, he will take the position of God. He will use the language of God. He will say, I am. And none else. Anywhere he is, he wants to be the controller and the Lord there. Self has not been crucified. I am. And none else. Look at the people that self had not been crucified from their lives. Chapter 47. Chapter 47 of Isaiah. I'm reading from verse 8. Therefore, hear now this thou, that art given to pleasure, that dwellest carelessly, that says in thine heart, I am and none else beside me. That's a human being. That's a mere man. That's a weak woman. And yet, he says, I will do what I want to do. I will go where I want to go. I am and none else. It takes that language out of the mouth of God and it holds onto it. It says, I am in this community. I am in this place. I am in this town. Anything I want to do, if I want to get rid of anybody, I am and none else. That's the self-life Saul used to have. But now he says, I am crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live, yet not I. It is Christ who liveth in me. And the life which I now live, I live by the faith of the Son of God who loved me and he gave himself for me. Come to Luke chapter 12. The self-life that must be crucified so that you can live in dependence upon the Lord. You can live relying upon the Lord. You can live by faith, faith in the Lord alone. This year, all pride will be canceled from our lives. All kind of self-life, that ego will be canceled all out of every life in Jesus' name. In Luke chapter 12, I'm reading from verse 17. Luke chapter 12, we're reading from verse 17. It tells us in verse 17, this is the life of that I, ego, edging God out. And he thought within himself, you don't even have to say anything. The way you carry yourself, that shows the way you are thinking. The way you look down on other people, that shows the way you are thinking. The way you think that I'm the master, I'm the Lord, the captain of my soul, the Lord of my life. Nobody controls me. Nobody talks to me. I am. Everybody will have to bow down because I am the one in charge here. That's a self-life. The Lord will cancel that this year. It will so circumcise your heart and crucify that self. You will live the life of faith, the life of Christ. It will be a beautiful life, a humble life, and it will be a meek life in Jesus' name. And he thought within himself, saying, what shall I do? That's the I there. Because I have no room where to bestow my goods. And he said, this will I do. I will pull down my barns and build greater. And there will I bestow all my fruits and my goods. You can see everything is the center of gravity. Is the center of attention. Is the center of thinking. Is the center of everything. I will do this. I will do that. He didn't reckon with God at all. God is not in the equation of his life. And then he says, and I will say to my soul, verse 19, soul, thou hast much goods laid up for many years. Take thine ease, drink, and be merry. But God, who says, I am God and none else. And anyone that comes in competition with him, it brings such a person down. But God says unto him, thou fool, this night thy soul shall be required of thee. Then whose shall those things be which thou hast provided? So is he that layeth up treasure for himself, for himself, for himself, and is not rich towards God. That self-life will be crucified. Is the old man, is the nature we got from Satan. That's why we get saved. That's conversion. And then we move on and we're sanctified. The second work of grace. The first work of grace is it's not our work. It's not our work. It's the work of Christ. It's because of what he did on the cross of Calvary. And we turned our lives to him. We repented of our sins. I will say, Jesus, not because of me, but Jesus, because of what you have done. The great work of redemption. Save my soul. We were saved. But then he says, husbands, love your wives. Even as Christ also loved the church and gave himself for it, that he might cleanse it and sanctify it with the washing of water by the word, that he might present that church unto himself, a glorious church, not having spot or wrinkle or any something, but that it should be holy and without blemish. It is through that same work of redemption, the shedding of the blood of Jesus Christ, we come after salvation to this sanctification experience. That's why it's called the second work of grace. It will do it in your life. Saved, you'll be sanctified. You'll be purified. He'll make you holy through and through in Jesus' name. Let's look at Romans chapter 6. Romans chapter 6, I'm reading from verse 6. In Romans chapter 6, reading from verse 6, here is what the Lord is telling us about the crucifixion and the taking away of that old man, old self. In Romans chapter 6, verse 6, knowing this, that our old man, that's a self-life, that's a self-nature, that our old man is crucified with him, that the body of sin might be destroyed, and henceforth we should not serve sin. You will not serve sin. Sin will not have dominion over you in Jesus' name. You are master over every circumstance. You are master over every temptation and trial. You will overcome in Jesus' name. I have overcome. I have overcome. Down deep in my heart. I can't hear you. Down deep in my heart. I do believe I have overcome this day. I have overcome. I have overcome. Down deep in my soul, I do believe I have overcome this day. We overcome sin, we overcome self, and it is this crucified life, as we surrender to the Lord, we come to overcome. You will overcome. I said you will overcome. Knowing this, that our old man is crucified with him, that the body of sin, the origin of sin, the body, the nucleus of sin, the one that generates and produces sin in your life, that the body of sin might be, tell me, destroyed. That's what Calvary does. I said that's what Calvary does. He'll do it in your life in Jesus' name. That the body of sin might be destroyed, that henceforth we should not serve sin. Look at verse 7. For he that is dead is freed from sin. He that is dead, I'm crucified with Christ. I am dead with Christ. I am buried with Christ. He that is dead is free from sin. Look at verse 11. Likewise reckon ye also yourselves to be dead indeed unto sin. So sin will not have dominion over you, will not have power over you. You'll not say, I couldn't help it. No, you can help it now. I couldn't resist it. Now you can resist. I didn't know what to do. The sin just came and then I yielded. I was helpless. You are no more helpless because sin will not have dominion over you in Jesus' name. Likewise reckon ye also yourselves to be dead indeed unto sin, but alive unto God through Jesus Christ our Lord. Let not sin therefore reign in your mortal body, that ye should obey it in the laws thereof. You are free. Am I talking to somebody there? I said you are free. Verse 18, being then made free from sin, ye became the servants of righteousness. Verse 22, but being made free from sin and become the servants to God, ye have your fruits unto, what's the word there? Unto, what's the word there? That's that holiness without which no man shall see the Lord. Ye have the fruit unto holiness and the end everlasting life. Number one is the proof of a converted soul. Number two is the portrait of a crucified self. Number three, the power of a conquering spirit. The power of a conquering spirit. The power of what? A conquering spirit. I am a conqueror. I am more than a conqueror. Galatians chapter 5. In Galatians chapter 5, we're reading from verse 1. Galatians chapter 5, and we're reading from verse 1. Stand fast, therefore. It says, now you are converted, stand fast. Now you are crucified with Christ, stand fast. You are saved, stand fast. You are sanctified, stand fast. It says your sins are pardoned, stand fast. Being justified by faith, we're peace with God, stand fast. It says your heart, your spirit, your soul is purified and cleansed by the washing of the blood of the Lamb. It says stand fast, therefore, in the liberty wherewith Christ has made us free, and be not entangled again with the yoke of bondage. You will not be in any yoke anymore. Verse 6, for in Jesus Christ neither circumcision of the flesh availeth anything, nor circumcision in the flesh, but faith which worketh by love. It's a faith in us that now works. It doesn't mean that after we are saved, we don't do any good thing. Of course, that's now we're energized and empowered, enabled to do good works. And it is a faith that worketh by love. Then he tells us in verse 9, a little leaven leaveneth the whole lump. You'll not allow a little sin, a little compromise, a little false doctrine, a little yielding to sin, a little crack in your wall of defense against evil. It says you mustn't allow that, because a little leaven leaveneth the whole lump. It's telling us that we're totally free. We're completely free. I am free. I said I am free. The Lord will confirm that freedom in Jesus' name. Verse 16, this I say then. If you are converted, this I say then. If you are crucified with Christ, this I say then. If you are committed and consecrated unto the Lord, this I say then. Walk in the Spirit, and ye shall not fulfill the lust of the flesh. Walk in the Spirit, and ye shall not fulfill the lust of the flesh. All the works of the flesh you will overcome in Jesus' name. We're reading Galatians chapter 6 verse 14. But God forbid that I should glory, save except in the cause of our Lord Jesus Christ, by whom the world is crucified unto me. Worldliness is crucified unto us in Jesus' name. You know why people are worldly? Because there's still something in their heart like a magnet, being attracted to the world. Actually, can I tell you something? If everybody in the world were blind and only you can see, you'll not be worldly. Because you know that he's blind, he doesn't know whether I'm putting on something green or something blue or something red or something yellow. And if everybody around you were blind and they couldn't sense, you say, how charming that is, how wonderful that is, how beautiful you look, how gorgeous you appear today. If nobody could pass that comment because they were blind, you would not be worldly. And so Paul the apostle is saying, I live my life as if only God is watching me. I am crucified to the world, and the world is crucified to me, and I cannot care a jot for what the world is thinking about me. I count them blind, I count them dead, and because of that, it doesn't matter to me their coming. And this is the life of victory, that you know that whatever they are, whoever they are, you live as unto the Lord alone. That concept will be in your life even from this day in Jesus' name. But God forbid that I should glory, save in the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ, by whom the world is crucified unto me, and I unto the world. For in Christ Jesus, neither circumcision availeth anything, nor uncircumcision, but a new creature. And as many as walk according to this rule, peace be on them, and mercy and upon the Israel of God. Who are the Israel of God? I said, who are the Israel of God? We are. You are, in Jesus' name. Now we come to Romans chapter 8 and verse 37. Romans chapter 8. I will read it from verse 37. Romans chapter 8, verse 37. It says in verse 37, name, in all these things we are more than conquerors through him that loved us. He has taken our weakness away. He has taken our impotency away. He has taken all the weakness of the waist and the weakness of the heart and the weakness of the mind, and then all the fear of the world and the fear of Satan. He has taken everything away in Jesus' name. Now we can say, nay, in all these things, I am more than a conqueror through Christ, through him that loved me. Okay, you didn't wake up, you'll wake up now. Are you all right now? Do you have confidence in the Lord? Am I reading this word only for myself? Am I reading it for you? What are you? It is yours in Jesus' name. Now you say, name. And why did he say name? Look up here. It's like somebody saying, I know who you are. Didn't I know you last year? Didn't I see how the devil came and then you fell down, rub your nose on the ground, then you look up and say, nay, this is a new year. Nay, this is a new period. Nay, something has happened unto me. I crossed over. Where are you? I crossed over. You know, somebody said, I'm going to do this to you this year because I know how to catch you. I know how to get you. I know how to bring you down again. Then you say, nay. I can't hear you. Nay. In all these things, I am more than a conqueror. Nay. In all these things, I am more than a conqueror through him that loved me. The conquering spirit. I said the conquering spirit. You'll have it in Jesus' name. We're looking at 1 John chapter 2. 1 John chapter 2. We're strong. This year, you will not be weak. This year, you'll not be weary. The strength of the Lord will abide and walk in your life in Jesus' name. In 1 John chapter 2, I'm reading here from verse 12. 1 John chapter 2. And we're reading from verse 12. The conquering spirit. I write unto you little children, because your sins are forgiven you for his name's sake. It says, that's the beginning, that's the commencement. You are converted. You are born again. Your sins are forgiven you because of Christ. Because of his sacrifice. Because of the blood is shed for you. In verse 13, I write unto you fathers, because ye have known him that is from the beginning. I write unto you young men, because ye have overcome the wicked one. Ye have overcome the wicked one. You know, the way some people read their Bible, the way some people preach, the way some people talk, it's like we're weak, we're children of men, we're dust and clay. As long as we're on this side of heaven, we shall always be overcome. There's a great devil, there's a terrible devil, and he puts us under his feet. What a pity that we're here. But we know one day the trumpet will sound, and then the dead will rise, and we which are alive will rise up, and then we go to be with the Lord, and that time we will have the victory. That's too late. I said that's too late. Now at this time, now in this present world, now in this present life, where there's temptation, where there's trial, where there's trouble, where there's affliction, this is the time we are strong in the Lord, in Jesus' name. In this present year that we have just started now, strength will come inside your heart, might in your soul. Everything that comes against you, you will overcome in Jesus' name. Look at what it says. It says, because ye have overcome the wicked one. I have overcome. I said, I have overcome. And that victory of the cross will be in your life in Jesus' name. You'll overcome sin. Give me a good amen. You will overcome self. Give me another good amen. You'll overcome strife. The strife of men, they fight against you in your community, anywhere you are. You overcome sin, you overcome self, you overcome strife, you overcome sickness. Every sickness that tries to come against you in your body this year, you are an overcomer in Jesus' name. You overcome strongholds. Every stronghold of the enemy, you're going to pull down in Jesus' name. And then you overcome the old serpent. His name is Satan, the devil. You'll overcome, because very shortly the God of peace and the God of power will put Satan under your feet shortly, in Jesus' name. Don't transfer the victory to the future. The victory is now. Don't transfer the victory to next year or to when Jesus comes again. That victory is now here, and you have the victory in Jesus' name. I'm going to read that verse 13 again. I write unto you, fathers, because ye have known him that is from the beginning. I write unto you, young men, because ye have overcome the wicked one. I write unto you, little children, because ye have known the Father. Verse 14, I write unto you, fathers, because ye have known him that is from the beginning. I write unto you, young men, because let the weak say, I am strong. I write unto you, young men, because ye are strong, and the word of God abideth in you. It's the word of power. It's the word of authority. And that word of power abideth in you. You overcome in Jesus' name. And ye have overcome the wicked one. Chapter 4, verse 4. Chapter 4 of 1 John, verse 4. Ye of God, little children, and have overcome them, because greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. Any amen there? Amen. Chapter 5, verse 4. For whatsoever is born of God overcometh the world. Anyone that is born of God overcometh this evil world, overcometh the occultic world, overcometh the afflicting world, overcometh the traditional world, overcometh the defiling world. It says, whatsoever is born of God overcometh the world, and this is the victory that overcometh the world, even our faith. I am an overcomer. I am an overcomer. And from this day till the rest of your life, the spirit of the conqueror will go with you and abide with you in Jesus' name. You will maintain the victory. You will sustain the victory. And the victory will never stop in your life in Jesus' name. Now it's time for you to stand. It's time for you to say, yes, Lord, I overcome. But before you stand, I have overcome sin. I will overcome sin. I have overcome self. I will overcome self. I have overcome strife. I will overcome strife. I have overcome sickness. I will overcome sickness. I have overcome all evil spirits. I will overcome all evil spirits. I have overcome strongholds. I will overcome strongholds. I have overcome Satan, the old serpent. I will overcome Satan, the old serpent. Stand up in your victory. Stand up in your victory. Yours is the victory. You are more than a conqueror. Open your mouth and talk to the Lord in prayer. He converts us. He changes us. He turns our lives around. He makes us overcomers. He makes us overcomers. Because the word of God abides in you. The word of God dwells in you. You know that this year is a year of victory. It's a year of triumph. You'll never be the same again. Because he wants to give you more. Whatever you've got, he wants to give you more. Something more. Something more. Something more. Something more than you ever had before. Are you saved? There's something more. Are you sanctified? There's something more. Are you filled with the Holy Ghost? There is something more. Are you sick? You can get well. Are you well? There is something more. Victorious. Victorious in Christ. Victorious in Christ. It makes you an overcomer. Turn to the Lord completely. Turn to the Lord completely. He converts, he changes, he saves, he forgives, he will turn your life around, and he gives us victory. Victory over sin, victory over self, victory over strife, victory over sickness, victory over stronghold, victory over evil spirits. And victory over Satan, the old serpent. Free and free indeed. Free and free indeed. This is a year of freedom, year of dominion, year of victory, year of progress. Free. Never to be bound again. Free. Conquer that cell. I am and none else. Conquer that. And know that as you are crucified with Christ, dead with Christ, buried with Christ, risen with Christ, makes you an overcomer through and through. In Jesus' name we pray. I am an overcomer. I am a conqueror. I am more than a conqueror. This year I will live in victory. Victory over every challenge of life. What is the person I'm talking about? It's coming your way. You overcome, you are an overcomer this year in Jesus' name. That kind of sickness that made it to be weak and all. Where did you go? Yes, I went to the hospital. Where did you go the other time? I was at the hospital. How many times in the year? I don't even know how many times. This year it will not happen. Because you will overcome. Because you have overcome. You will carry victory with you back home. Authority with you back home. Power with you back home. Hey, you will not be a beggar, you'll be a giver. You will not be jobless. Everything you need is supplied in Jesus' name. This world will not rub your nose on the ground. And the powers that be will not rub your nose on the ground. You will stand and then you will square your shoulders. You'll say, I'm a child of the King. He provides for me. He supplies all my needs. He conquers all my problems. Am I still talking about somebody there? Raise up those anointed hands. Those hands will be blessed beyond description this year in Jesus' name. Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank you because you have made us conquerors. And I pray, oh Lord, for every brother and every sister, the victory you have given us will be real in Jesus' name. I pray, Lord, all the sins of the past, you will cleanse away. All the sins of the past, you will cancel. I will pray that no sin will stick to our lives, will remain alive, and the blood of Jesus will cleanse us from all unrighteousness in Jesus' name. Crucified with Christ. Crucified with Christ. We'll live the victorious life in Jesus' name. And Lord, I pray, everyone today, hearing the sound of my voice, you have the spirit of the conqueror. You will not cry for the devil. You will not bend before the devil. You will not cringe in the world. You will not compromise in the world. Lord, I pray, give all your children the spirit of the conqueror in Jesus' name. Lord, I pray, the power that conquers sin. Grant unto everyone in Jesus' name. The power that conquers self. Give unto everyone in Jesus' name. Lord, the power that conquers strife. I pray, Lord, no weapon that is fashioned against anyone here will prosper in Jesus' name. All the strife coming from the enemy. All the conflict coming from the enemy. Anything fighting against your life, they are defeated, they are destroyed, they are brought under your feet in Jesus' name. Your yokes are broken. Your cross is taken away. Lord, every one of your children here, this year, the sick is well. Those who are infirm and weak, they are strong. I command right now, any sickness in your body there, because of Calvary, because by the stripes of Christ, you are healed. I command you, sickness, come out in Jesus' name. Anything that is called pain, anything that is called incurable disease, I command you right now, come out in Jesus' name. I pray that everything that has tormented you until this point will come under your feet. The power of the enemy will come under your feet. All those evil spirits will come under your feet. You will stand in the liberty wherewith Christ has made you free. Stand as a conqueror. Stand as an overcomer. Stand as a victor, and this victory will go with you throughout your life in Jesus' name. And Lord, I pray that your people will overcome every evil spirit. In this evil world, the evil world will not crush them, will not conquer them, will not destroy them. And I pray that even that Satan will be under their feet. That old serpent will be under their feet. From this very day, the hand of the Lord be upon you. The promise of the Lord be fulfilled in your life. The joy of the Lord be your strength. You'll be head, you will not be tail. You'll be above, you'll be not be beneath. Every good thing the Lord has given you, you will possess. You will enjoy. And you will go through life victoriously in Jesus' name. As you go back home, go back with all the blessings of God upon your life. Evil people will clear away from your sight. All those calamities will clear away before you. Conquering, you have conquered. Conquering, you will conquer. Conquering, you will continue to conquer. Until Christ will come, nobody will take your victory from you. Lord, confirm it in every life. We thank you because we know you have answered. In Jesus' name we pray. In Jesus' name we pray. I am an overcomer. Tell somebody by your side there before you go. Don't just rush out. Talk to them. I'm victorious. I am an overcomer. And the things that brought me down last year, this year will not bring me down. You will always overcome. The next time I see you, you have a testimony.